are the thrill seekers, corrupt and immoral.
We all remember the trends and fads that were part of our childhood, things we can look back on with fond nostalgia. Growing up in the mid to late 90s and early 2000s, it seemed to be trend after trend, from Pokemon to Pogs to really obscure clothing. The word extreme with an X was probably the most used word at that time. One trend that was so notorious with the 90s was skateboarding. You had magazines, clothing lines, TV shows, skateboards themselves, and of course, video games.
I spent hours upon hours playing through games like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 1 and 2, Thrasher Skate and Destroy, and Street Skater, listening to the jams and learning the words. I can still recite Bring the Noize by Anthrax and Public Enemy word for word, and if you don't believe me, ask me to do it in person if we ever cross paths. Matter of fact, I've seen both these groups live multiple times, and I thank Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 for introducing me to that song. I had so much fun and created so many memories playing those games, but at a certain point, I stopped playing them, and then suddenly, they stopped coming out. And not just Tony Hawk's games, but skateboarding games in general. I wanted to know why something so popular that the leading franchise sold over 30 million copies just disappeared. Was the quality of the games? Was the trend starting to fade out? Let's have a look at the winding history of the skateboarding video games. The 80s saw a massive influx in freestyle skating, with Rodney Mullen being at the forefront of it in the real world. And in the virtual world, we saw games like 720, Skateboarding, California Games, and Skate or Die released, and it wouldn't be until the next decade we would see the skateboarding hit the massive pop culture trend we all remember. The mid-90s is dominated by street skateboarding. It's become this massive subculture. ESPN held its first ever Extreme Games in 95. This X Games was a huge success and helped pull skateboarding closer to the mainstream, and closer to being accepted by the general population. We also got our first notable video game release in 1998 with the release of Street Skater. Street Skater is a skateboarding video game released for the PlayStation 1. It was released in Japan in 1998 under the name Street Borders, then was licensed to EA for distribution in America in 1999. Street Skater also included a soundtrack. This would be among the first time I would hear some of these artists and would mold my musical taste at the time. Artists like Less Than Jake, H2O, and Straight Faced. I remember thinking to myself when playing this game that this could not be tops. This was exactly where it was gonna go. This was the music I wanted to listen to. This is the game I wanted to play. Skateboarding consumed me at this time. Little did I know what was just around the corner. In January 1998, a company by the name of Neversoft was just about to run out of money. They had a fortunate meeting with Activision, who were looking for someone to redevelop their game Apocalypse, a failed internal project featuring the voice of Bruce Willis. Neversoft got to work and finished the game 9 months later. After successfully releasing Apocalypse, Activision tasked Neversoft with creating a skateboard game. Neversoft, never having worked on a sports game before, began working on what we would know as Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. Tony Hawk was a popular figure in skateboarding, and in September 1998, Activision signed him to the project. On August 31st, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater was released. It was like nothing ever seen before. The influx of kids buying skateboards was rampant. Everyone wanted in on skateboarding. 1999 would also see Tony Hawk become the first skater to land a 900. It was considered one of skateboarding's most technically demanding tricks, and helped cement Tony's name in skateboarding history. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater would go on to sell over 5 million copies globally. But Activision weren't the only company working on a skateboarding title. Thrasher Skate and Destroy was published by Rockstar in 1999. Despite having less recognition, it received some pretty high scores from reviewers, being seen as technically superior to Tony Hawk. Aside from its less advanced graphics, the learning curve was also quite steep compared to the pick-up and play style of Tony Hawk's games. You had to learn moves, and couldn't button mash your way through your combos. This led to the more casual player gravitating to Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. It was a great attempt to rival Tony Hawk's for the market share, but it came up a little short. We wouldn't see a follow-up for this game, while on the other side, Tony Hawk's kept trucking through to its sequel. Tony Hawk Pro Skater 2 released on September 20, 2000. Around the same time we saw a massive outburst from CKY and Jackass. I can recall shifting from wanting to learn how to do tricks, to be the most technically gifted in the neighborhood, to doing insane stunts and jumps after discovering the more goofy side of the culture. The music got heavier, clothes got baggier, and the bales and falls stopped being sore and started being funny. It was a strange time for the culture, but it integrated so well. Endless nights of watching MTV for Jackass and watching tapes of CKY playing Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 was incredible. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 changed me for the better. It got me totally into skating every time I wasn't playing the game, wanted to emulate some of the cool tricks I saw in-game, and the cool skater videos and bales gave this cool real-life crossover from collecting secret tapes. Jackass and CKY, on the other hand, not so much. I did some dumb stuff thinking it was cool from what I saw on those tapes. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 is known for its great level design, bump and soundtrack, and cast of skaters and movesets that meant playing through this game was never a bore. And if you did ever get bored playing the career mode, it also included a creative park mode, which let you dream up your own skate park to mess around in. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 sold 2 million copies in its first week and went on to sell 5.3 million units in its lifetime, and it's ranked the second on the list of greatest video games of all time. With the success of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2 and the popularity of extreme sports on the rise, Activision created a subdivision that would work on extreme sports games exclusively. Activision 02 went on to make Matt Hoffman's BMX to cater for the BMX crowd using the same formula as Tony Hawk's. They also released Kelly Slater's Pro Surfer, Sean Palmer's Snowboarder, and even a wakeboarding game. It was fair to say the extreme sports trend was gaining momentum, and with ESPN's X Games, you could consume extreme sports in and out of the video game world. The thing was, however, all those other games shared very limited success. By 2003, Activision would discontinue the O2 publishing and their attempts at the pro branding, focusing purely on the Tony Hawk's games. During the Activision O2 era, we saw two Tony Hawk's games released, Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3 and 4. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3 introduced the revert, allowing players to extend combos. The game stood out in the franchise for being the first title to have online capabilities. Users could connect directly to other players online on the PS2 version, even prior to the launch of the network adapter with a USB Ethernet adapter. Pro Skater 4 is a departure from the previous three games' career mode, in which the player has a set amount of time in order to find and complete goals. 4, instead, featured a career mode more similar to free skate mode, in which there was no time limit to explore the level, and goals were usually offered to the player by characters found on the level. This career mode would be later seen as the story modes of the Underground series, American Wasteland, Project 8, and Proving Ground. What we can see here is Neversoft pushing themselves to make each game unique in some way or another. Each new iteration has something the previous one lacked. They weren't just a cash grab type of copy-paste game we see more commonly today. During these years, we saw a lot of imitation games come through, such as Simpsons Skateboarding, Goofy Skateboarding,
He's extremely goofy skateboarding.
MTV Skateboarding, and is that Snake on a skateboard? Yeah, we got a lot of imitations, and they had their moments, but overall these games were a flash in the pan, quick cash in from a variety of different companies. Tony Hawk's moved away from the Pro Skater moniker after Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 4. We saw the birth of the Underground series after that. Tony Hawk's Underground 1 was created with the theme of individuality. It stars an amateur skater in a true story mode, whereas each previous Tony Hawk's game had starred professional skateboarders and had lacked a plot entirely. One reason for only allowing the player to use a custom character was that certain criminal acts completed in the plot would not reflect well on real-world skaters. Neversoft expanded customization in Underground by implementing face scanning for the PS2 version. If the player emailed a photograph of their face to faces@thugonline.com, they could get their face in the game. This is another example of Neversoft continuing to try and improve and try new things with their games. Tony Hawk's Underground 2 had a massive influence from Bam Margera. It wasn't just Tony Hawk anymore, it was more like Tony versus Bam. Bam was a massive reality star at the time, and it made sense to include him the way they did. I remember playing through the story and hearing all the voice acting done by the real people. It was so dope. It was more of a wacky Jackass inspired title, which some fans didn't like. It's up there as one of my favourites to this day. Moving on to 2005, we saw American Wasteland's release, which focused on a Cali skate scene for the most part. His title boasted no loading screens between levels, instead opting for a kind of a long hallways that you skated through to mask the load times in the background. Clever for its time, but ultimately, I think I'd rather see a cool splash screen for a few seconds with the music in the background instead of just skating the same hallway over and over again. Project 8 is where I personally stopped playing the franchise. Not that it was a bad game, it was quite well received, but the trend of skateboarding had completely left my life, and it did for many others too. The world moved on, and the tag-alongs and trend followers were onto the new trends of the time, and we began to see a rapid decline in the popularity of skateboarding. Tony Hawk's had been riding high up until now. Nothing could knock the Birdman off his perch. Until 2007. Activision released Tony Hawk's Proving Ground in 2007, but it wasn't the only skateboarding game to release that year. EA had also released their game Skate, a flick-it style game where instead of using a combination of buttons like in Tony Hawk's,
the player would flick the analog stick in different directions that correlate with the move they were trying to do. It was a breath of fresh air to the genre and overall carried massive success. Skate outsold Proving Ground in a 2-to-1 ratio. Outside of video games, skateboarding is on the decline. You can see a massive drop off in people looking for skate parks, skateboards, etc. And why is this? It's fair to say that when something like skateboarding is at its peak, the status quo keeps changing. The bar keeps getting raised all the time, which leads to a harder learning curve for newer participants to achieve. A lot of hardcore skaters blame scooters, as it's a much easier way to pick up a scooter and learn tricks day one than it is to skateboard. And let's be honest, people grow up, and they grow out of it. People get career jobs, families, etc. Don't have time to be skating around everywhere. Skateboarding was focused on the youth and a revolution of culture. And its day and age, technology like smartphones and services like YouTube are more important to kids than skateboarding will ever be. Hell, even the pop punk and skate metal music isn't half as big as what it was in its heyday. There's about to be a deadly cocktail served. One part mainstream pop culture losing interest in skateboarding, and a premier skateboarding franchise switching developers and ultimately switching focus. In 2008, Neversoft said goodbye to the Tony Hawk series and began focusing on the recently acquired Guitar Hero. Who took over the Tony Hawk franchise, you ask? We begin our Robomotor journey with the release of Tony Hawk Ride, a game that came with a skateboard peripheral for about €130. And boy, was it bad. In the first month of the US release, it sold about 114,000 copies, more than it ever should have. This thing was a disaster. Games Radar gave it a 4 out of 10. They also named it the worst game of the year, using its skateboard peripheral as the trophy for the anti-awards feature. Not a good start for Robomoto, but they learned from their mistake, right? I mean, they couldn't be that brave to do something like that again, could they? The same year Activision pushed this crap out, EA released Skate 3. Skate 3 is regarded as the best skate game on the market. Tight controls, massive free roam areas, and tons of replayability. It was easy to see what game the consumer wanted to buy. I mean, let's be fair. If you walked into a game shop and saw both on a shelf, we all know which one we'd most likely buy. Skate 3's popularity died out, but it had its own renaissance with popular YouTubers making Hall of Meat and skate videos, along with funny moment compilations. There was little that could be done for Activision to become the Mac Daddy of skateboard video games again. EA had taken the crown, and it was for the better. But then, in 2012, a phoenix rose from the ashes. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater HD remaster was released. Finally, years after the last good Tony Hawk's game, our prayers were answered. It would be a nostalgia field trip and a breath of fresh air. But then we played it. The game felt slow as tar, the animations were junk, the game bugged out, and overall, it was the most disappointed I've ever been with any sort of remake or remaster. The genre would take a hiatus after this, and not until about 2015 would we see the last skateboard game release. Neversoft closed its doors in 2014 with a very fitting send-off, a Viking funeral for the company's mascot. It's a sad thing when a company who cared about the product and had fun making it closes down. But I'm glad that Neversoft was dead and buried before Activision and Robomoto put out the final Tony Hawk game. I remember working in GameStop when the game launched. I was super excited for it. It didn't include a plastic skateboard for me to use, didn't have any gimmicks, it looked like it was a grassroots pro skater game with improved graphics. Then I remember launch day, having to tell people that once they put the disc in the console, they'd have to download a massive day one patch. It was later revealed that it wasn't a patch, so to speak, it was the rest of the game. The thing was pushed out with just a demo level on it, and you had to download the rest of the game. What a slap in the face. I live in Ireland. We have decent internet in the cities, but if you live half a mile outside of a city, it's dial up for you, baby. So downloading massive updates is a no-go for a lot of customers, which meant having to crush someone's spirit by telling them not to bother if you're not online with your Xbox, because you only play the demo. The gameplay sucked, it was a buggy mess, and will never be fixed. It was the biggest slap in the face to the community I've ever seen. A quick cash grab before they lost the license to Tony Hawk, and it ended up ruining what was left of its good name.
What it does not fail at
is product placement. Here's two side by side, which is real nice. You may have noticed the Mountain Dew garbage cans.
You may have noticed that every timer in the game is branded with Nixon watches. You may have noticed that there are billboards for GoPro and the Sony Action Cam. There's just every conceivable
every
piece of product.
Every square inch of it is. And this is, I don't know if, did we mention this is a $60 game? Did you know Lil Wayne is made of helium? Just inside there, he's actually a big balloon
man.
He
does have a much higher pitched voice than.
Look at that! Those two were back to back!
That was cool because gravity actually shifted an entire 90 degrees for that one to work.
It's like, It's
oh, hit the
there I ran into God. It's just like
E3 2018 saw a surprising announcement. Session from indie developer Creature Studios. A skateboarding game, quote, heavily inspired by the golden era of skate culture of the late 90s and the early 2000s. A great concept on paper, but is it too late? Have we all moved on from the skateboarding genre? Only the few hardcore fans are left, others moved on from skating, and others resentful to return to the genre due to being burned way too much in the past. I've seen demo gameplay of this, and it looks like an even more hardcore skate game, which is fine for some, but I want to pick up and play a combo game more than I want a convoluted control system to pull off a kickflip type of game. The only saving grace is Thug Pro, a fan-made Tony Hawk game that stays true to where the games came from, and where they are most successful. It's free to download, and although the players on it are insanely good at it, it's a good time just to skate around and enjoy yourself. I think it uses the Tony Hawk's Underground 2 engine and goes all the way back, and you should definitely check it out if you're looking to scratch that itch. I'll always hold skateboarding and the video games around it very close to me. It influenced my musical tastes, it taught me about patience and practice, and that it's the only way to master something. There are memories I have with friends I lost contact with many years ago, but I can still look back on it with a big smile. From being young, going out to try to recreate the tricks we saw on videotapes, to staying up late playing Tony Hawk's Pro Skater. It's a trend I don't see coming back anytime soon. Video games have moved on to create bigger and better worlds to explore, leaving only the ruins of a once great franchise in its wake.